prapanna parijataya totra vetraika panaye jnanamudraya krishnaya gita amruta duhe namaha om. Dear friends, welcome to the study of Gita. We were reading the second chapter, that is Sankhya Yoga, and we were reading the shloka number 40. That is, Neha Vikramana Shosti Pratyavayu Na Vidyate. That was the shloka. And the overall context is that Krishna is introducing this idea of Karma Yoga. We often hear about Karma Yoga. There are very famous books by very famous people. For example, Bala Gangadhar Tilak, he wrote huge volume on Karma Yoga. And many people, not only Bala Gangadhar Tilak, many people have debated on this Karma Yoga. So this concept he is introducing. And he has been saying that in this Karma Yoga, there is no wastage of effort. Whatever little you do, it is going to give you some good result. Na iha abhikramanashosti, he is saying. Iha means in this Karma Yoga. Abhikramanashaha means wastage of effort, whatever little you have done. Suppose you are doing some yajna or some such ritual. In that ritual, unless you complete that ritual in a very, very meticulous manner, you will not get the result. According to our Mimamsa Shastra and all that. Suppose you start some yajna, some Rudra Yagam or something like that. You have to do everything so perfectly. And if you don't do everything so perfectly, the mantra has to be chanted in a very perfect manner. And all this paraphernalia, they have to be absolutely as per the prescription. So if there is anything wrong, the result will not come. So that is what the Mimamsakas, they say about yajnas, etc. But here in this Karma Yoga, there is no such thing. And what is the great difference between Karma Yoga and that Mimamsaka, we are going to see shortly. But here he is saying, Naiha Vikraman, there is no wastage of effort and no Pratyavaya. Pratyavaya means though there is no negative result. Suppose you are doing some yajna and suppose there is one person who is supposed to be reciting some Rigveda or something and that gentleman is absent. If the gentleman is absent, that karma is not complete. So, if that karma is not complete, then there is a negative result for that. Suppose a person chants the mantra in a wrong manner, even for that there is a negative marking. For example, there are some stories on this point. For example, there is one shloka which says, mantro heenaha swarato varnatova. For example, when a mantra is recited, when the swara is wrong, swara, I think yesterday also I was telling you about this swara. Swara is a particular intonation. And varnatova, suppose one particular letter is missing, then that becomes a sort of vajrayudha and it hits the yajamani. It adversely affects that person who is performing that yajna. And there is a story also, that small story of Indra and Vritrasura. For example, there was one demon who was killed by Indra. And that demon's father, he also happened to be a rishi, and he performs a great tapas in order to get a son who would be able to kill Indra. And while doing that tapas, he was making a sankalpa. Sankalpa is Indra Chatrur Vardhasva, Indra Chatrur Vardhasva. So something like that he was supposed to say. So instead of saying that Indra Chatrur Vardhasva, he put the emphasis on Indra, Indra Chatrur Vardhasva. So instead of getting a son who was capable of killing Indra, he got a son who would be killed by Indra. So that is, when there is some change in the intonation, there is a change in the meaning also. So mantra, it is like that. So that is the reason why in Vedas, there is one particular ancillary text for Vedas. For example, we know that there are Vedas like Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, etc. There are many other ancillary sciences which are needed for the proper understanding of the Veda. Those ancillary texts are, for example, Vyakaranam. Vyakaranam means grammar. Then there is another subject called phonetics. That is called Shiksha Shastram. Shiksha, there is a particular word called Shiksha. Shiksha means, in Telugu we use the word wrongly. Shiksha means punishment. It is not punishment. Shiksha means education. Or in Vedic Sanskrit, it is the science of phonetics, how exactly it has to be pronounced. There, they say that a person has to chant the mantra, the words in such a way like a tigress carries its cub. Oh, you visualize one tigress. Of course, we don't see a tigress. We may see a female cat, That cat, how does it carry its kitten? Because tiger and I am, that shloka says tiger, but because we don't see tiger carrying its cubs, I am giving the example of a cat. That cat, how does it carry its kitten? It holds it by its own mouth, and it has got very sharp teeth. And when it is carrying, it should not press too much, and it should not relax also. If it presses too much, it is going to bite it, and it is going to hurt it. If it loosely holds, it will fall off. So you have to pronounce the every letter in such a way, like this tigress carries its cubs without pressing too much and without losing, without relaxing too much. Yatha vyagri haret putran damstrabhyam, damstramit teeth, sharp teeth, nacha pidayet, means it should not press too much. Bhita patana bhedabhyam, if it holds loosely, then it will fall down. And if it presses too much, it will bite. So tadvad varnan prachodayet, a word has to be pronounced in such a way, in any language. Of course, in Sanskrit, particularly for the Vedic mantras, the mantras have to be chanted with the same particular intonation. So that is how, in fact, the Vedas have been preserved. They are said to have been preserved only because Vedas are also called Shruti. I think I told you also. Shruti. Shruti means something which has been heard. Which has been heard from father to son, father to son, father to son. In that manner, it has been transmitted over generations and generations. And how is it preserved? The purity of the language, how is it preserved? Purity of the text, how is it preserved? Because the intonation, it should not change at all. So these people, they were so perfectly preserving that intonation. Like you listen to the classical music, so something like that, like classical music is preserved. So similarly, the Vedic texts are also preserved. And every word has to be pronounced in such a perfect manner. And there should not be any type of deviation. So like you see in that film, My Fair Lady, that Professor Higgins. Professor Higgins, he trains that girl as to how to pronounce English. So something like that. In fact, linguistics is an offshoot of the study of our own Shiksha Shastra. That is, if you see Shiksha Shastra, then you will find that linguistics is an offshoot. Or rather, it is a new science which has come into existence in the 18th century. After the Europeans, they studied the Sanskrit language. Anyway, so this pratyavaya, we deviated from this word pratyavaya. So if a word is wrongly pronounced, then there is a negative result. But in this karma yoga, there is no negative result. Pratyavayo navidyate swalpamapyasya dharmasya trayate mahatobhayat. He says, Krishna is saying, yes, even if you do a little bit of this karma yoga, it is going to lead you, it is going to give you positive result only. Why? The difference we have to understand is that if you are doing a ritual and that ritual is going to, it is promising you some result which is going to come at a later time. Suppose somebody is Swarga Kamo Yajeta, for example. There is somebody who wants to go to heaven and he is performing a yajna. And that promise is something after the fall of his body. Immediately he is not going. If Lord Indra were to send a vehicle immediately, this gentleman also will not go. No, sir, will you wait for some time? I have to perform my daughter's marriage or my son's education is pending or something like that. We will not be interested in going immediately. So, that phalam is something which is adrushtam. Adrushtam is not seen. Whereas in this karma yoga, the phalam is immediate in the sense that in this karma yoga, a person is doing a particular prescribed activity without expecting any result, without seeking the punyam. Result means without expecting the punyam. Suppose you are doing some yajnam, that punyam is there. So you don't want that punyam, but you are doing it for the sake of doing. You are doing it as a matter of duty. Suppose every householder, he is supposed to perform some yajnam, danam, etc., some sort of charitable deeds. So he will perform it. Yes, this is my duty. As a matter of duty, I am doing it. And this is because of my action, somebody is going to be helped. So he is doing it as an order, as a part of the divine scheme, putting himself as a sort of servant in that divine scheme and acting according to the divine will. So that is what is karma yoga. Karma yoga does not mean that you do karma and then you don't expect results. Suppose you are going to your office and you do your office work, and then at the end of the week or fortnight, karma yoga does not say that you should not receive the paycheck. It is not about that. It is not about such activities which are meant for the livelihood of a person. So karma yoga is actually referring to the Shastriya karma, what we call Shastriya karma. That is the kind of karmas which are various rituals which are mentioned in the Vedas, which are said to give you punyam, papam, etc. Of course, even in the office type of work also, suppose there is some public interface, we can also apply this karma yoga concept even to a modern office situation. Suppose you are going to some government office, and in that government office you are getting so many files, and every file means file. What is an office file? File is something which is some request or some problem or some issue relating to a particular person. So you have to see the person behind the file. When you are seeing a file, it means that you have to see the person behind the file, and you have to see that justice is done to him. So long as your duty is to do justice, if you are doing justice, you are within the confines of karma yoga. But if you are not doing that justice and you are expecting something else, you are expecting some shortcut or some you want to deviate from your duty, then you are coming under this negative result. So this karma yoga concept can be applied to the modern context also. Wherever there is some public interface, you are going out of the way to help this help the people. You are seeing the man behind the file, and then you are taking a decision. So then you are doing your karma yoga. Karma yoga does not refer to your fact of accepting the check, paycheck or not. It is not asking you not to take salary. You please take salary, but at the same time, do the work in a perfect manner. So that is how karma yoga has to be applied to the modern context. But here in the Gita, he is talking about karmas which are promising some swarga or some such phalam, some adrushta phalam as we say. So that is what this particular shloka says. We'll just take a break and come back. We will resume. So this shloka is saying, this shloka number 40, Svalpamapyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. So what is the visible result in this karma yoga? The visible result is you are doing some activity with a pure heart. With a pure heart in order to help a fellow individual, in order to do something good for the other people. So when you are doing something without expecting anything, it's not some type of missionary activity. It is you are doing something as a matter of your duty, as something which has to be done by the individual in order to help the society. So from that point of view, that antahkarana shuddhi, what we call purity of mind, comes. So this purity of mind is what is the visible result, or in Sanskrit we call it drushta phalam. Drushta means something which is seen, not dushta. Dushta means bad. Dushta is bad, and drushta. Drushta means that which is seen, drushta phalam. Something is a visible result, that is a purity of mind. And why is purity of mind emphasized in Vedanta? Suppose you are reading physics or mathematics or chemistry or something. If you are reading mathematics, purity of mind is not needed. You may be a criminal, I am not talking about you, somebody, X, so and so, X may be a criminal, he may be a great scientist. And that criminal scientist, we see in movies also, all the Bond movies are about evil genius, some evil genius as the villain. So that evil genius can be there. And a person who reads chemistry or some other subject, he need not have that purity of mind. Whereas a person who is in this spiritual path, who is studying Vedanta, he has to have a pure mind, because he is aspiring to be Brahman itself. He is aspiring to equate himself with Brahman itself. Because what does Vedanta say? Vedanta says that you are in essence not different from that supreme reality, and you have to realize it. And if you have to realize that you are that Brahman, you are not different from that Brahman, the mind has to be absolutely pure, and in that pure mind you have to listen to what that Vedanta says about what is the nature of, what is my nature, what is this Jagat, what is that supreme reality, and how am I that. So this thing will not happen unless that purity of mind is there. So suppose the mind is full of dirt. Into that dirt, God cannot come and sit. Only the mind, God cannot come into a mind which is already cluttered with so many bad things. God can come into a mind which is pure. So that purity of mind is a sort of prerequisite for the higher level that is called the Jnana Yoga, we are going to see later. Now we are in this Karma Yoga. This is the spiritual progress is like a ladder. So first of all, a person who is doing bad activities, he is at the lowest level. A person who is doing Nishiddha Karma or prohibited action, somebody who is stealing, somebody who is harming others, so that man has to be brought back to the level of doing some permitted karma. He should be prevented from doing bad karma. He can do some permitted karma. So that is one level. From this permitted level karma, he has to come to what is called Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga means not seeking the result. That is, he is now coming to the level of purity of mind. After that, he has to go to the next level called concentrating his mind, and then what is called Dhyana. That is, this purity of mind alone is not enough. You should not only be pure, but should also be focused. So purity and focus also has to be there. That focus will come only by meditation and things like that. And also what is called Patanjali Yoga, that Dhyana, all those things. And thereafter one has to, simply because of purity, it will not, Atma Jnana will not happen, self-knowledge. One has to go to a teacher, one has to study what is called the Upanishads. And in those Upanishads, what is told about Atma, Brahma, etc., he has to apply it to himself. That application is very, very important. It is called Anusandhanam. That application is very, very important. And by that application, he slowly realizes and slowly he comes to that level. So that is why, Swalpamapyasya Dharmasya. So even if you do a little bit, it is leading you to some purity of heart. It is giving you, suppose every day, in fact in Boy Scouts, when we were school children, in Scouts there is a principle. That is, you have to do some good act every day. One good act every day. So by that, naturally, of course I don't remember whether we were doing or not, or whether we were capable of doing any good act. Because as school children, what great good act will you do? Anyway, we didn't have much money also. Anyway, some good act, suppose you are doing every day. So then it leads gradually to some purity of mind. So that is that drushtaphala, so visible result. So that is how it trayate mahatobhayat. What is this great fear? Mahatobhayat means it protects you from the great fear, it says. What is that great fear? The fear of transmigration. If a person is not having that purity of mind, if a person is doing karma after karma after karma and then asking for punyam and punyam and punyam, etc., etc., he may be doing some punyam, he may be doing some papam. Once he goes to Tirupati, he will also do something else. So that what punyam you got in Tirupati is compensated by something else. So it punyam, papam, that balance is positive, negative, it is there, and then he keeps on rotating in this cycle of birth and death. So, but here, this Karma Yoga is leading to that purity of mind. So that is what Krishna is introducing to that concept. And the next shloka also he says the same. Vyavasayatmika buddhihi ekeha kurunandana bahushakha hyanantascha buddhayo avyavasayinam. Here he is saying vyavasayatmika buddhi. Vyavasaya does not mean agriculture, or in Telugu we say vyavasayam means agriculture, tilling a land. But here in Sanskrit, vyavasaya is not that. Vyavasaya is nishchaya, that is determination. And that determination, when does it come? Only when you examine a particular thing in a proper manner, when you analyze a thing in a proper manner, when you examine a thing, when you do what is called viveka. Viveka means proper inquiry into the nature of it. So when you do that, then naturally, the mind becomes clear and you arrive at the right decision. A right decision is only a result of right enquiry. And that right decision, once you take, then your action also will be right. So here that's what he is saying. Vyavasayatmika buddhi rekeha kurunandana. O kurunandana. This firm mind, a clear mind, is only because of that clear thinking. If clear thinking is not there, a person is getting distracted here and there. Bahushakha anantascha buddhayaha avyavasayinam, he says. Bahushakha means, in Vedas also, in Vedas and in all our texts, as I said, Veda is not only for the person who wants to be a philosopher, not only for a person who wants to be a sannyasi and who wants to realize Brahman. Vedas are for everybody, for you and me, for everyone. Vedas are, they have to take into consideration the whole society. And this whole society, they are in various levels. Somebody is very ignorant, somebody is in a very, very ordinary level, somebody is in a slightly better level. So, depending on the level of people, the Vedas have to give whatever they want. So, that is why somebody said Veda is like a huge mall. Whatever you want, you have it. So, that is why there is what is called Karma Kanda. Vedas, if you see gradually, there is what is called Karma Kanda in the beginning. They talk about, you do this particular karma, you will get this result. You do this particular ritual, you will get this result. So, whatever you want. So, that great mall. So, it is like that Karma Kanda. Then after that, slowly and slowly, it also tells in between, don't stop with this. Try to know what is the higher thing. So, the next level after Karma Kanda is what is called Upasana. You know the nature of a god. Suppose we hear about what is called Upasana. Oh, so and so is a Upasaka. He is a Saraswati Upasaka. Or so and so is a Hanuman Upasaka. And somebody else is, okay, some other Upasaka, Shiva Upasaka or Vishnu Upasaka, whatever it is. So there, what happens? There you are focusing your mind. You are focusing your mind and trying to know what is the nature of the deity and then trying to acquire some of the qualities of the deity. That is again a very important thing in Upasana. Upasanas are again of different types. I will not go into the details. Upasanas, a simple level is, I am the servant of this god. This god will protect me. That is the very simplest level. And a slightly better level is, I have to understand the nature of Vishnu. I have to understand the nature of Shiva. I have to acquire, I have to imbibe some of those qualities. I have to become stronger. So that is another level. So different types of upasanas they tell. So from beginning is Karma Kanda. The second level is what is called Upasana. The next level is what is called Jnana Kanda. Jnana means knowledge. Knowledge is about what? Knowledge about the nature of that supreme reality. Nature about your own self. So it is otherwise called, Jnana Kanda is also called the Upanishad. That Upanishadic portion is called the Jnana Kanda. So Vedas take into consideration all these levels. But here, a person and this Upanishad, or rather Jnana Kanda, gives you that rational thinking. At the Karma Kanda level, it is talking at the level of religion, let us say. It is talking at the level of, you worship this god, you worship this, you are going to get this. But in this Upanishad, when you come to Upanishad, there is a logical thinking about what is that reality means. It does not talk about a person. It does not talk about some god sitting in heaven, etc. It is talking about that supreme reality in terms of consciousness, etc. So once you realize your real position, then your activity will be totally different. Your own action in the society will be totally different. So, vyavasayatmika buddhi ekeha. So, when you have this proper inquiry, then you have got a fixed, a clear understanding. When you don't have clear understanding, then you are getting drifted from one branch to another. Bahu shakha. Shakha means, for example, in a tree, you have got a tree, a branch is called a shakha. And sometimes you find hotels, Shakahara. It is not Shakahara. In Telugu, very, very wrongly we hear those titles. Shakahara Bhojanashala. It is not Shaka. Shaka means branch. Shaka means vegetable. So vegetarian, in order to say vegetarian, they say Shakahara. Instead of saying Shakahara, sometimes they say Shakahara. Shaka is wrong. But here, of course, Bahu Shaka is so many branches. What are those so many branches? So we talk, Vedas talk about, you do this, you follow this path, you follow that path, etc. So that is the reason why our people, suppose I have a desire and I worship so and so Ganesha for some time and I don't get the result. Immediately somebody suggests, you go to this Darga, if you go, it is good. I go to that Darga and there also I don't get the phalam. And somebody says, no, you wear this particular some ring or some bracelet or something. Or you wear some other ring or you wear some Rudraksha. All these things. And somebody else says, no, you come and then I will make you do some sort of ritual, etc. So you drift from this Baba to that Baba, this Darga to that Darga and this Swami to that Swami, etc. So that is what is Bahushakaha, Anantascha. So, a person who has not known what is the reality, A person who doesn't try to inquire into the nature of reality, he gets drifted from in all these manners. So that is what we see. Bahushakah anantascha buddhayo avyavasayinam. So what Gita says, one should have that clarity of mind. One should have that clarity of mind. If we don't have that clarity of mind, if we don't have that clarity of understanding, we get drifted from this to that. Everybody will be kicking us around. So some Swami comes and then, okay, this Swami is a great Swami. Okay, you go and fall on his feet. Somebody else comes and then, okay, somebody else says, okay, you go and touch his feet. So we will be doing all that. So Gita says, you please understand the things properly. Thereafter you decide. So bahushakha hyanantascha buddhayo avyavasayinam, it says. Then we will come to the next shloka, that is 42nd shloka. 42nd shloka, Krishna is telling more strongly. He is saying, yam imam pushpitam vacham pravadanti avipaschitaha vedavadaratah partha nanyadastiti vadinaha. So two, three shlokas, but I will read shloka by shloka. Yam imam pushpitam vacham. He says, Krishna is saying, all these Vedas, they are talking in all these flowery terms, in all this flowery language. That is, you perform this thing and you will get this result. You do this, you will get this result. Pravadanti avipaschitaha. Vipaschitaha means, vipaschit means somebody who sees very clearly. Paschyati. Paschyati in Sanskrit, paschyati means sees. Vipaschit means a person who sees clearly. Avipaschit means a person who doesn't see clearly. That means who has no clarity of mind. So this avipaschitaha or avivekinaha. We also use the word viveki and aviveki. Aviveki means A person who has such confused thinking. So a person who is having such confused thinking is an aviveki. So an aviveki who goes after all these flowery words. So Vedavada Rataha. They say, okay, Veda has told this, we have to follow this. Vedavada Rata. Veda has said this, yes, we will follow this. And Nanyadasti. Nanyadasti means apart from this heaven, there is nothing else. Heaven is the supreme. Heaven alone is there. Nanyadasti means there is nothing else. Heaven is supreme. So such people, they are really foolish people. Krishna is saying very, very harsh words. We will continue tomorrow. Harihi Om Tat Sat.